to you today about problem gambling in Europe. Are your headphones working? Can you all hear my presentation in Spanish? Yes? Can you put your hand up if you can? Great. Okay. Good. You will be delighted to hear that I'm going to keep my presentation very brief, so you can all go to dinner soon. But what I have to say is very important. I have a lot of facts for you, a lot of statistics for you, that may feel quite a lot today to hear all at once. But I think that you will be able to obtain a copy of this presentation if you want to refer to these figures at some point in the future. I will cover the prevalence of problem gambling in Europe with an emphasis on Spain. I'll talk about prevalence rates worldwide, and I'll mention adolescents briefly, and I'll mention types of play as well. I will talk about internet gambling a little bit, and then I'll see what time it is. It may be that we don't get on to the next, but I aim to take less than 20 minutes to do this. Much of the data that I'm going to present is based on the report called Problem Gambling in Europe, an Overview. And I think some of you are taking notes. This is a very big report, but it's extremely comprehensive. And this, what I'm giving you, is just a tiny, tiny bit of what is there, and also what is in the British Gambling Prevalence Survey of 2010 and 2007. And I'm mentioning some of the Spanish studies by Bacona as well, that a lot of you will know about. So the prevalence surveys across Europe have shown large differences in rates of problem gambling between countries. If we look at the types of screening tools, we have four different types, and some of you will be familiar with these and some of you won't. It doesn't matter, they're just four different ways of screening for problems. But you can see that if we're measuring people in Europe and comparing rates, and we're using different screening tools, this in itself might be one of the reasons why the figures that I'm about to show you are quite different from each other. It may be that these European differences are attributed to different screening tools, or that they are linked to higher vulnerability factors within different populations. Or could the differences be due to variation in availability of gambling products? All of these things are possible, and some of you will have very strong opinions, and later after the presentation we can talk about this. Estonia has one of the highest prevalences at 6.55% of the population presenting with problem gambling diagnosis issues. Finland is at 5.5, and then the countries go down: Holland, Germany, Great Britain at 0.9%. This is from the 2010 survey, so it's actually our rate at the moment. And again, Sweden at 0.3. If you look at the rates worldwide, okay, they're quite similar. Canada 0.5, South Africa 1.4. Hong Kong, Macau, these are very high rates of problem gambling. I think because they're being assessed using the Chinese diagnostic screening tool, or is it that the type of gambling that happens in Hong Kong and Macau is the type of gambling that might lead people to develop more severe problems and eventually show up positive on our screening tools? I don't know. In Spain, Bacona and company did the 2004 survey on problem gambling lifetime prevalence, and it came out at 0.92, so similar to the UK one. It's a small sample, 1,600 odd people. That's not large enough for us to be sure that this is the actual prevalence rate, but it was a good enough study to be quoted and to have an idea of what's happening. In an earlier study, we found a past-year problem gambling rate of 1.6% of the general population, and that was pulling together four different regions and getting an average. In 1990, another Spanish professional conducted a study in Catalonia using the Sarcos gambling screen, which is one of the four that I mentioned earlier, and found a lifetime prevalence of 2.5%. Again, the sample was relatively small. And in Andalusia, there was a 1.6% in 1999. Of course, even 3 or 4 years in the history of a country can make a big difference, particularly nowadays when our gambling laws might be changing relatively quickly, or governments change and introduce different legislation. So I'm still quoting the earlier statistics because I think it's interesting for you to know. I want to tell you a little bit about adolescence. A recent study from 2011 showed the prevalence rates in young people are higher than in adults across all countries in Europe. We knew this clinically, but it's very helpful to have this in research papers. So in Great Britain in 2009, the national sample of 11 to 15 year olds showed that 2% have a problem with gambling, considering they're not supposed to be gambling at all. This is a very worrying statistic. In Italy, 13 to 20 year olds were assessed and a prevalence was 2.5%. In Norway, teenagers had a similar prevalence. A regional prevalence survey of 2001 in Spain of 14 to 21 year olds showed a problem gambling prevalence of 4.6%. The instrument used was results revised for adolescents, also used in Sweden on their young people, but their prevalence was on only 0.9. Why is that? It could be that the samples were so small that actually we just picked on two separate samples that might actually, in the end, in a bigger population, have given similar results. Or it could be that Spanish young people have a bigger problem, in which case, why is that? I'm going to move on to types of play now, and I have here a list of top gambling forms by gross gambling revenue. So, how much money they're bringing in. In Great Britain, betting and lotteries are at the top. And in Italy, lotteries and betting. In Germany, lotteries and gaming machines. And in Spain, gaming machines. The majority of European studies have identified electronic gaming machines, slot machines, as you know them, as the most common type of gambling amongst problem gamblers. This was found in Estonia, in Great Britain, in Germany, in Holland, in Norway, in Sweden, and in Switzerland. And this is very recent. If we look at internet gambling and problem gambling, a secondary analysis of British Gambling Prevalence Survey shows that of the forms of gambling most played by problem gamblers, only one is not remote. So, 6 odds betting terminals, electronic gaming machines essentially. 11% of those who played in the last year who played on these machines were problem gamblers. I don't know if this is surprising to you, but it's very interesting to me as a clinician. And we see high rates of playing these machines at our clinic in London. The other types of play that attracted problem gamblers were spread betting at 14.7%, doing it in the last year, betting exchanges at 9.8%, and online gambling at 7.4%. The other interesting thing is the number of gambling activities. So if you are a problem gambler, you have played and you play on a lot of different things. And that's another way of finding out that there are problems there.